Welcome back to our MedSmarter lecture series, where we're taking a smarter approach to preparing future physicians. Before we get started, if you'll take just a quick minute and click that like button, and also subscribe and turn the bell on so that you'll be notified when we post new videos. Let's continue on in our discussion of gram-negative bacteria, and today we're going to do a little bit of a compare and contrast between Salmonella and Shigella. They are both very commonly confused, so we're going to discuss some various things that are different between the two to help you get those questions answered right on the test. So first and foremost, both of these, Salmonella and Shigella, are going to be gram-negative rods. Okay, we've already established that. We're talking about gram-negative bacteria. They are also both non-lactose fermenters. They are both oxidase negative. And then they can invade the GI tract with the M cells of Peyer patches. So if you see back gram-negative rods in Peyer's patches, it's probably going to be Salmonella or Shigella. You got to remember that it could be either of those. So we need to investigate them further with further information from that question to be able to determine which particular one we're dealing with. And then even beyond that, what particular treatment that we need to use. So let's look at a chart here that's going to give us some information to compare and contrast Salmonella and Shigella. We're specifically going to talk about two different types of Salmonella. We have Salmonella typhi and then just all the other Salmonella species except typhi, as you can see in that second column. And then Shigella will be on the third column here. So what are the reservoirs for these various bacteria? Well, first and foremost, what is a reservoir? Remember, the reservoir is the habitat which these normally live and grow and multiply. So with Salmonella typhi, these only grow in humans. So it's not going to grow elsewhere and then come into humans. You know, think of ticks and that kind of stuff and how those can disseminate elsewhere. With Salmonella that is not typhi, not only can it be in humans, but it can also be in animals. So that's an important aspect there. And then Shigella is in humans only as well. So the difference between these three is that the other Salmonella species besides typhi can have an animal reservoir. How do these spread? Well, hematogenously is going to be the way that Salmonella, all Salmonella species are spread, whether it's typhi or all of the others, they can all spread hematogenously. Shigella, however, does not spread through the blood. It's only going cell to cell. Do any of these produce hydrogen sulfide? Well, all of the Salmonella species do, but Shigella does not, so that's going to just differentiate between those two. Salmonella all have flagella on them. That helps them to do a salmon-type swim, where it beats back and forth, where it can move along in the blood there. So both the Salmonella species have that. Shigella does not, which is why it has that cell-to-cell spread. It cannot move on its own. What causes the virulence with these particular bacteria? With Salmonella typhi, it's an endotoxin as well as a VI capsule. This is important for something that we'll talk about in just a little bit, so keep that in mind. The Salmonella typhi does have a VI capsule. All the rest of the Salmonella species only have that endotoxin. They do not have that VI capsule. And then Shigella has the endotoxin as well as the shigatoxin, which is an enterotoxin. So what is the infectious dose required for these particular bacteria to become infectious? So this is known as the ID50. If you can remember back, what does the ID50 mean? That is going to be the value or the dose of bacteria, specifically in this case, where these particular infectious agents are required to cause an infection in 50% of the test subjects. So how high of a dose do 50% of the patients have to have to cause infection? Okay, so with Salmonella typhi, they have a high large inoculum required. So they have to have a lot of this bacteria present to cause an infection in about 50% of the patients. Why is that? Well, it is acid labile, meaning that it's inactivated by gastric acids. So if this is consumed, then the stomach acids can actually cause a decrease in the potential transmission and infection of Salmonella typhi. This is also the same story for all the rest of the Salmonella species. This is different, however, for Shigella. Shigella is acid stable, meaning as it goes through that digestive tract, It's very resistant to the highly acidic environment of the GI tract. Therefore, it only takes a low amount of this particular bacteria to cause an infectious disease. So if we treat these with antibiotics, what happens to the excretion of them? With all of the Salmonella species, giving antibiotics will prolong the duration of fecal excretion, whereas with Shigella, it's going to shorten that duration. A couple more things to discuss here between these three different types of bacteria. The immune response for Salmonella typhi is mostly going to be monocytes, whereas the rest of the Salmonella species and Shigella, polymorphic neutrophils are going to be part of the immune response for those particular infections. How do these manifest themselves, especially in the GI form? With Salmonella typhi, they get constipation followed by diarrhea. With all the rest of the Salmonella species, we have diarrhea by itself. It could be a bloody diarrhea. And then Shigella causes a crampy abdominal pain where you get that tenesmus or that muscle spasm, and that can also cause a bloody mucoid stool. So if you remember back to just a minute ago, we talked about the virulence factor and how Salmonella typhi has the VI capsule. That's important for this next point, the vaccine. Can these have a vaccine to decrease the risk of infection? The answer to that is yes, if they have that VI capsule. So we can do an oral vaccine that will have the live attenuated version of Salmonella typhi against that VI capsular polysaccharide. Without that VI capsular polysaccharide, there's no ability for us to create a vaccine against the other Salmonella species or Shigella. Therefore, they have no vaccines for those cases. All right, and a couple other things. What are some unique properties about these specific ones? So Salmonella typhi has a particular disease named after it, and that is typhoid fever. To treat typhoid fever, we're going to use ceftriaxone or a fluoroquinolone. This can actually colonize the gallbladder in patients that are carriers. So we talked about this only has a human reservoir, so it can colonize the gallbladder and then potentially excrete out of the body in the feces that could then potentially infect other people through some contaminated surfaces. The other Salmonella species outside of Salmonella typhi are found most commonly in poultry, eggs, pets, and turtles. Remember, we said that this can be found in animals. So the other Salmonella infections found in animals like poultry, eggs, pets, and turtles. We don't have any indication for antibiotic use to treat Salmonella outside of Salmonella typhi. These are usually self-limited and they will resolve upon their own most of the time within 24 to 48 hours. If we do have a patient that has gastroenteritis, that's often going to be one of those Salmonella non-typhoid type bacteria. Furthermore, Shigella follows the four Fs: finger, flies, food, and feces. That's the most common causes of transmission for Shigella. It is important to note that the invasion of the M cells with Shigella is what is key to its overall pathogenicity. That actually allows it to have a very little dose of toxin to cause the disease. If you found this material helpful for your studying, please like and consider subscribing to the channel. Also, share this video so that more people can benefit from it like you have.